Hey everyone, welcome to United. My name is Brad Benwick and I'm here with
Charlotte.
And here at United we exist to point students towards Jesus.
Is this working? All right, I want everyone to turn to your neighbor and tell them one wise decision you made this week.
Charlotte, what is one wise decision you made this week?
One thing I did this week, I helped around my house without my parents asking me to.
That's truly amazing. That is truly amazing.
How about you, Brad?
I didn't procrastinate one assignment this week at school.
Wow. That's amazing. I'm so proud.
Anyways, guys, if it's your first time here at United or if it's your 50th time here at United, in the seat back in front of you or in the first row, they're going to be under your seat. There's Connect cards. Fill them out if you're new. Take them to the back right room. Jacob will be there at the end of the service. And we'll give you a free t-shirt just for being here.
Also on those Connect cards, there's a notes section. So you can fill out any notes or anything that stands out to you during the sermon. There's also a prayer request form. So if you have any prayer requests, you can fill it out and drop it in the cubbies. And our team will pray for you throughout the week.
Now, Charlotte, I have a question for you.
Yeah.
What is going on between February 19th and the 21st?
Well, we have Epworth.
Charlotte, what's Epworth?
So Epworth is in St. Simon's Island, Georgia. It's a retreat. It's the biggest retreat of beach students. We go and we grow closer to God and with everyone around us. It's an awesome experience.
What are you looking forward to most?
Personally, for me, it definitely has to be the dance. Now, it's going to be 70s and 80s homecoming theme, so make sure to wear the tackiest thing you can find. What's your favorite part?
My favorite part, besides growing in my faith, is the Epworth Bowl. I was on the red team last year. We won 28-0. I hope the blue team has a little more pride in their game this year to put up a better game.
All right, we also have this thing called Devos. Brad, do you want to explain that?
So Devos, which are short for devotionals, are a time, like a 15 to 30 minute time where we spend time growing closer to God. On the Beach Students Instagram story, every single day we post Devo topics for you guys in case you're in need of inspiration or guidance in your faith journey.
All right, now we're gonna go ahead and transition into a time of worship. So feel free to stand, move around, sit, do whatever you need to do.
Thank you.
washing over me. Your face is all I seek. You are my everything. Jesus Christ, you are my one desire. Lord, hear my only cry to know you all my life. Love so deep is washing over me. Your face is all I seek. You are my everything. Jesus Christ, you are my one desire. Lord, hear my only cry to know you all my life. I'm wide awake, drawing closer by grace. Oh,
sit high, and you see low, and you know. know all. You have such a powerful wisdom, such a powerful presence on us. It's so undeniable, so tangible. And I ask you, God, to just fill the room. Just fill the room with your presence tonight. And whatever we're going on with relationally, spiritually, mentally, physically, just cleanse our thoughts tonight and just focus on you. In Jesus' name, amen.
My name is Merrick and I'm in seventh grade. I grew up pretty normal, but we didn't go to church. I had no idea who Jesus was and I had no relationship with Jesus. The first time I came to church was from my friend, and I went to life groups and I really enjoyed it, so I kept coming. I thought life groups were pretty cool and that I can meet a lot of people that are going through the same stuff as me. I got more involved with church and then I ended up going on the Albany mission trip this year. I gave my life to Christ on the Albany mission trip, and when we were doing a worship song, God has changed me through the course of me going to life groups. He's made me more mature to talk about Jesus with my life. Jesus inspires me to make new friends so I can spread the gospel of Jesus to other people. I wanted to get baptized because I wanted to show people that I went public with my faith. I'm Merrick, and that was my testimony.
What's up, everybody? Welcome to United. Welcome to week three of No Regrets. Everybody say No Regrets. No Regrets. This is a series all to help you live a life with no regrets, or at least fewer regrets. Fewer regrets. Literally, we want to do this series to make your life better. And the thing that makes your life better is the idea of wisdom. Everybody say wisdom. Wisdom. Wisdom is understanding the best choice and actually doing it. Wisdom is understanding the best choice and actually doing it. It's not just knowledge where you know something, but it doesn't translate to your actions. You understand the best choice, not just the acceptable choice, not just the legal choice, not just the what can I get away with choice, but the best choice and actually doing it. And if we live a life with wisdom, we will live a life with fewer regrets. Because, as we've talked about throughout this series, you can learn in one of two ways. The first way is experience. Everybody say experience. And the second way is wisdom. Experience hurts, wisdom doesn't. That's what we've been saying throughout these weeks. Experience hurts, wisdom doesn't. Again, the same example I've been using, but you don't have to touch a fire to understand it's not a good idea to touch a fire. You don't actually have to burn yourself, harm yourself, and live with those regrets and those scars to learn something. You can learn that way. It's just not the smart way to learn. Like, you don't have to learn by hurting yourself and then doing it differently next time. You can learn from wisdom. Wisdom is learned from people that are older than us. It's learned from people that are more experienced than us. It's learned from reading, from knowledge. And most of all, we believe as Jesus followers that it's learned from God himself. Because if there's a God, then doesn't it make sense that God would know the best way to live? And so we turn to God's word, especially for wisdom, because there's things written in this book, even if you're not sure about Jesus, there are things written in this book that are undeniably wise, that if you live by, your life will be better. And so we want to learn through wisdom. And the question that we've been asking throughout these weeks, and the question that we want you guys to leave this series with is this: in light of my past experiences, my current circumstances, and my future hopes and dreams, what's the wise thing to do? What's the wise thing to do? In light of my past experiences, my current circumstances, and my future hopes and dreams, what's the wise thing to do? Why don't we just say, what's the wise thing to do? Because we all have different wise things to do, because we're all different people. We've all come from different places, come from different families, have different backgrounds, have different struggles. We're all in different circumstances right now. Some of you are 15 years old and in 9th or 10th grade. I'm in a different circumstance than you. I am older than you. I have kids. I'm married. Like, I'm in a different place than you are. And so we have different things that are wise for us. But in addition to that, we all want different things from our life. Some of you want to pursue careers that make a lot of money. Some of you want to just pursue your passions. Some of you want to go to certain colleges or play certain sports or have certain dreams realized. And because of that, you have to live differently than other people. What's wise for you may not be wise for someone else. And so instead of just saying, well, what's the wise thing to do? We have to personalize it. We have to personalize it. And we have to ask ourselves, in light of my past, my present, in my future, what's the wise thing to do? And as I've been saying, I didn't make any of this up. This comes from one of my favorite books ever called Ask It by a guy named Andy Stanley. And if you want to read the book, we got a couple copies in the back if you want to get one. But really, this question has changed my life, and that's why I want to share it with you guys. And tonight, I want to speak specifically about how to apply this question to one of the largest regrets most of us have. Often, when people talk about their biggest regrets, it's not about money. It's not about bad grades. It's not about getting in a car accident. It's not about your job or sports or failing with something or like any of those things. It's not about a certain injury. It's not about even a friendship that ended or whatever. Generally, a lot of times, your biggest regret comes in the area of your morals, but specifically in the area of sex. I know. Y'all are like, I don't want to hear about sex. Well, listen, we're not going to do a whole series about it. We're just going to talk about it one night. And remember, this is meant to help you. This is meant to make your life better. And it's just a reality that people often struggle the most with their sexual regrets, Few regrets last longer than those that come from unwise sexual decisions. Few regrets last longer than those that come from unwise sexual decisions. I've talked to people that years and years, decades after they made certain decisions, I was talking to a guy a few weeks ago who's like grandparents' age, and he was talking about something that he did when he was 20 years old sexually that still to this day haunted him. And it was 50 years ago. And he was telling me about it. Like, it does not necessarily just go away like other things. Other things you can kind of be like, you regret them for a while, but then you forget about them. But a lot of times, those sexual mistakes stick with us. You might hear someone joke about, that time they got drunk, or that time they failed a class, or that time they spent a bunch of money unwisely. But you rarely will hear people sit around saying, let me tell you about the time I cheated on my wife. It was great. You rarely hear people say, let me tell you about the time that my family fell apart. Let me tell you about that awesome pornography addiction I have. You just don't hear people joke about that. Why? Because often, no one wants to joke about these kind of regrets. Because again, these regrets will stick with you in a different way. And I want you to hear this. Sexual sin is not worse than other sin. Let me say it again. Sexual sin is not worse than other sin. It's not worse than gossip. It's not worse than pride. It's not worse than judgment or condemning other people. It's not worse than anything else. But it is different. Some of you teens like to say, it just hits different. Paul said this in chapter 6 of 1 Corinthians. He said, flee from sexual immorality. We'll come back to that. But then look at the next reason why he says that. He says, all other sins a person commits are outside the body. Listen to that. All other sins. So he's separating sexuality and sexual sin from all other sins. He says, all the other sins are different. But sexual sin is against your own body. It's within your own body. It affects you differently. It is not worse. It is not unforgivable. Jesus doesn't hate you because you messed up sexually. Listen, he loves you in spite of anything you've done. But it does affect us differently. And so we must ask ourselves the question, what's the wise thing to do when it comes to sex? What's the wise thing to do when it comes to sex? And I want to define sex for you because I know all of you think different things when you hear sex. So let me just define it for you. It is this. Sex is any behavior that brings sexual satisfaction. It's a pretty big, broad definition of it. But it's any behavior that brings sexual satisfaction. So it is lust. It is pornography. It is masturbation. I know y'all are like, oh my gosh, I can't believe you said that. It is old school sex, whatever, old school, I don't even know. The one that you learn about in science class, I don't know. It is messing around, it is sexual DMs and sexual messages and all that kind of stuff. It's anything that brings sexual satisfaction. And if you go into life, listen to me, again, even if you're not a Christian, listen to this. If you go into life approaching sex thinking, is it right or wrong? Is it legal or illegal? Is it Is it acceptable or unacceptable? Well, what's everyone else doing? Listen, you will live a life with so many regrets. You do not want to take your cues for sex from social media. You don't want to do it. You don't want to take it from influencers. You don't want to take it from movies. You don't want to take it from the internet. You don't want to take it from what your friends are doing. Reality check, your 16-year-old friend is just as dumb as every other 16-year-old. It's not like I know some like high schoolers like, I know it all because I've had sex with like two girls. Like, awesome. Like, you don't know anything. You're 16. We lie to ourselves and act as if, well, they did it, so it must be okay. Well, you know, it's not against the law. Listen, there is most sexual sin is not against the law. And yet it will ruin lives. And it will destroy futures if you approach it from what's, is it really wrong? Is it illegal? And so we want to ask, is it wise? It is wise. Is it wise? So Ephesians chapter 5, verses 15 through 17, we've been reading it throughout this series. We want to read it again tonight. Be very careful. Be very careful then how you live, how you walk. Not as unwise or foolish, but as wise. Making the most of every opportunity because the days are evil. Look at verse 17. Therefore, do not be foolish. Most of us want to be foolish in the area of sex. We're like, I don't really care. I don't really care if I'm foolish. I'm just going to do what I want to do. Most of us just want to do what we want to do. But do not be foolish. Understand what the Lord's will is. Here's my challenge to you. For the next few minutes, just try to understand the Lord's will. At the end of the night, you might be like, not about it. But just try. Just try to understand, because a lot of times we're like, oh, I'll give my eternity to God. I'll give my sin to God. I'll give my money to God. I'll give my future to God. I'll give everything to God. But sex, I'm going to keep that. I'm going to do what I want with the area of sex, because there's something about us that just wants to like kind of stiff arm anybody that wants to say anything about sexuality or anything about our sexuality. And so we just push God away. My encouragement to you tonight is to just try to understand. Just try. Just open your mind for a few minutes and listen to what God's word says. And we're really just going to focus on one small area of what he says about sex. But hear this. God's commands in the area of sex are meant to protect us. God's commands in the area of sex are meant to protect us. I know you feel like, well, but I can't do what I want to do. Well, but like, I don't want to follow Jesus in this area because like, I want to just do what I want to do. I just want to live how I want to live. I want to challenge you to just think about, what if everybody in the world, all 8 billion of us, just listened to this one command? One command, which is this, really, I mean, when you break it all down, God says, keep sex in the commitment of marriage. That's it. God says, keep sex in the commitment of marriage, and don't let it outside of that place. That is his command when it comes to sex. Imagine a world where 8 billion people just kept sex in marriage. I want you to just think about this for a second. Think about this. There would be no sexual abuse. There would be no rape. There would be no molestation. There would be no sex crimes. There would be very, very, very few unwanted pregnancies, meaning there would be very, very, very few abortions, meaning we really wouldn't even have arguments about it because people just wouldn't be doing it. There wouldn't be unwanted pregnancies. There would be much, much fewer broken families because of adultery, because of pornography, because of all the things that come from sexual promiscuity or sexual sin, sex outside of the marriage. There would be fewer broken families. There would be more mothers with their families, more fathers with their families. Like, think about this. There would be a world with no sex trafficking. There would be a world where it was just kept within marriage. There would be no pornography. There would be no pornography addictions. Like, the world would be radically, radically different, radically, radically altered. If people just listen to this one area, when you start to kind of zoom out and get outside of just like your own, like, oh my gosh, I got my hormones and I'm just going crazy. If you just get outside of yourself for a second and you look at the big picture, I think we can all agree the world would be better if we would just listen to God's commands in the area of sex. But here's what we do. The main question we ask ourselves is, well, what do I feel like? When it comes to sex, we're just like, what am I feeling? But I really want to look at those images. But I really want to be with her. But I really want to be with him. Well, it's just one night. It's no big deal. I really, really want it. Listen. If you follow your feelings, it will lead to regret. If you follow your feelings, if you listen to your feelings, it will always lead to regret. especially in the area of sex. I mean, if you follow your feelings in finances and really with selfishness and just with the way you use your time, it's going to lead to regret. But especially in the area of sex, when you lead with your feelings, when you lead with your heart, it will lead to regret. Jeremiah, in Jeremiah 17:9, this is written thousands of years ago, said this about our hearts. He says, the heart, or your feelings, are deceitful above all things, and they are beyond cure. Your heart is beyond cure. I know you're like, listen to my heart, I'll just do whatever my heart says. That's a terrible idea. It is a liar. He says, the heart is like the biggest liar in the world. It's beyond cure. Who can understand it? Your feelings will lie to you. You will tell yourself, well, it's just one time. You will tell yourself, well, I won't get caught. You'll tell yourself, well, it won't end this way. You'll tell yourself, well, it's not going to mess up my relationship. It's not going to mess up my future. You will tell yourself all kinds of things to allow yourself to do what your feelings want you to do. Listen, you cannot allow your hormones and your body's physiological reactions to control your life. If you do, it will lead to regret. It will lead to vast, terrible mistakes, things that you can never take back, things that you will regret for a long time. Do not just listen to your body and to your feelings. You've got to find something else to listen to. And I want to lead you through a story in Proverbs chapter 7 that shows how sexual sin, how sex outside of marriage happens. And I'm going to tell you the moral of the story before we even get to the story so that you can kind of see it as you read the story. Here's the moral to the story. Sexual sin always comes through a series of unwise choices. Sexual sin always comes through a series. Everybody say a series? A series. That means more than one. That means there is a pattern, a buildup, if you will, to our unwise sexual choices. Sexual sin always comes through a series of unwise choices. But before I get into this story, let me just make a disclaimer. If you've ever been sexually abused, sexually taken advantage of, none of this applies to you. It is not a sin. It was not your fault. It was the other person's fault. There's nothing you could do to change it. It is not something to regret. I just want to make that very clear, because this is talking about the choices that we make sexually, all right? And so I want to make sure we separate those two things out. If you've ever experienced that, I want you to know that is not something that God needs to forgive you for. That's not something that you've done that's wrong. That is totally separate from this conversation, okay? And so this is talking about our sexual choices, the things that we decide to do. Sexual sin always comes through a series of unwise choices when it comes to our decisions. So this guy is going to share a story. I don't know if it's true. I don't know if he really saw this happen or if he's just kind of writing poetry, but he's going to give us this example, this illustration of someone going into sexual sin. And when you read it, you're going to be like, this guy is so stupid. I can't believe someone would do this. And then you'll be like, oh, I think I've done that. I think we've all done this. Here's what he says, and starting in verse 6 of chapter 7 in Proverbs. Again, this is written thousands of years ago, but somehow it's still relevant to us today. At the window of my house, I looked down through the lattice. So imagine there's a guy, he kind of lives in a condo on Main Street. He's got a little balcony, and he's looking out at the main road in the market and just seeing people walk around and all that kind of stuff. And he said, I saw among the simple, I noticed among the young men, a youth who had no sense. Ignore whether it's a guy or a girl, just it's a young person. He saw among the simple, a young person, a youth who had no sense. Now, this person is not dumb. He doesn't know. He's just saying this person is unwise. They made unwise choices. Here's why he was unwise. Verse 8, he says, he was going down the street near her corner. Whose corner? Who's her? I don't know. We're going to find out in a second. But he's going near her corner. It says he was walking along in the direction of her house. And when is he doing it? At twilight, as the day was fading, as the dark of night set in. You might have a grandparent who said, nothing good happens after midnight, or nothing good happens after dark, whatever. This is what is happening here. He is going out at a particular time when it's dark, when the darkness is setting in, when people might not see what he's doing, and he's going in direction. He's going towards some woman's house. Then out came a woman to meet him. So she comes to him. She kind of meets him as he nears her. But I want you to remember, sexual sin always comes through a series of unwise choices. He's already made a few unwise choices. At some point, he met this woman. He knew what she was about. He found out where she lived. And then he decides, I'm going to go near her house. And I'm going to do it not at noon, not when all my friends are around. I'm going to do it at night when no one's going to see me. And then out she comes to meet him. And she's dressed like a prostitute, and she has crafty intent. Now it's going to give us a little background. It says, she is unruly and defiant. Her feet never stay at home, which is a biblical way of saying she sleeps with everybody in town. Now in the street, now in the squares, at every corner, she lurks. And so she took hold of him and kissed him. But she couldn't kiss no one, right? If he had not gone towards her house, she would have no one to kiss. She'd have no one to meet. If he didn't go at night, perhaps she wouldn't have just come out and grabbed him and started making out with him. But he chose to go that direction at that time, towards her house. She kisses him, and he doesn't stop her. And she starts talking. She says, today I fulfilled my vows. I have food for my fellowship offering at homes. She's gotten everything together. She got a dinner. She got all her stuff in order. And she says, so I came out to meet you. I looked for you, and I have found you. I wonder how she found him. Maybe it's because he was like a little puppy dog just sitting outside her house, just waiting. Just wait. Oh, is she going to answer? Let me run away. Hey, how you doing? Hey, remember we met a few weeks ago? Yeah. Oh, you want to have sex? Huh? Okay. All right. This happened because he went in that direction. She didn't have to look hard. He was right outside her house, and she found him. And now she's going to lay it on thick. I've covered my bed with colored linens from Egypt, which colored linens would be very, very rare in this time and very, very expensive because nothing had color. To have color, you would have to dye something, and that costs a lot of money. So she has these very expensive, like million count thread sheets on her bed. It's just feels like you're laying in, I don't know, Vaseline or something. And she's perfumed her bed with myrrh and aloes and cinnamon. So she got her essential oils out. She got lavender and peppermint and whatever ones make people want to have sex. So she got everything ready. There's steam blowing everywhere, okay? And she says, let's drink deeply of love till morning. That's a lie. They're not going to have sex all night. That's not how it works. I know that's what happens in the movies, but they're going to have sex for 5 minutes and it's going to be over. Maybe not even that long. And, yeah, let's enjoy ourselves with love, love, love. All right, my husband this is a warning sign. When she brings up her husband, he probably should have walked away, okay? See how funny it is? We're like, this guy's an idiot. Remember, unwise choices lead to sexual sin. It's always a series of them. It's a series of them. My husband's not home. And guess what? He's not gonna catch us. Oh, good news, thank you, awesome. He's gone on a long journey. And he took his purse, his man purse, one of those little, y'all are all wearing those ones now, right? The fanny pack, but now it's cool because you wear it across your chest. Yeah, okay. So he's got the fanny pack on. He's got full of money. So he's not coming home for a couple weeks. So no one's going to find out. No one's going to know. No one's going to know. And with persuasive words, she led him astray. She seduced him with her smooth talk. Now, verse 22 is, it's such a lie, but this is how we always feel. It starts out with these three words, all at once. Everybody say all at once. But was it really all at once? No, it wasn't all at once. He wasn't just in his room and all of a sudden he was having sex with some woman who had a husband. Like that, he didn't just teleport into her bedroom. He walked towards her house. He picked out the time to do it. He kept talking to her. Even when she brought up her husband, he doesn't leave. He keeps on talking. He keeps on, oh, okay. Oh, you got sheets, you say. That sounds great. Essential oils, awesome. I'm coming down to your house. This is going to be great. He didn't walk away. He kept on talking and all at once. But it wasn't all at once. He put himself in the situation. This is what we do. It never happens all at once. You don't just like walk, you're not just walking down 3rd Street and all of a sudden you're having sex with somebody. Like it just doesn't happen. You're not just walking down 3rd Street and all of a sudden you're looking at pornography. It takes a lot of steps. You have to go to private places. You have to pull out computers. You lock doors. You take off clothes. Like there's a lot of different things that lead to sexual sin. A lot of steps. A lot of unwise choices. But then all of a sudden it feels like all at once I just couldn't help myself. I'm sure he couldn't because he put himself in this situation. All at once he followed her. Like an ox going to the slaughter, like a deer stepping into a trap till an arrow pierces his liver, like a bird darting into a snare, little knowing it will cost him his life. Now then, my sons, my daughters, listen to me. Pay attention to what I say. Do not let your heart, your feelings, turn to her ways. And who is her? It's not about the woman. It's about lust and sexual sin. Don't let your heart turn to her ways or stray into her paths. Many are the victims she has brought down. Her slain are a mighty throng. Her house is a highway to the grave, leading down to the chambers of death. All sin, sexual sin, comes from a series of unwise choices. So what does wisdom say? We know what's not wise. Here's not wise. This is the perfect picture of not wise. So what's wise? Wisdom tells us to take extreme measures to protect ourselves in the area of sex. Wisdom tells us to take extreme measures to protect ourselves in the area of sex. I want to contrast Proverbs, this young man, with another young man earlier in the Bible, a guy named Joseph. Joseph, in the story that we're going to talk about, I talked about it a few months ago. He finds himself as a servant or slave in the home of a guy named Potiphar. Potiphar was an Egyptian official, a high-ranking official, and he becomes in charge of this man's house. And he's young and he's good-looking, and Potiphar's wife gets a little crush. So she starts coming after him, and repeatedly she tries to have sex with him. Hey, you're my servant. Come on, come to bed with me, have sex with me. Over and over and over again. And one day, he keeps rejecting her. He keeps saying no. One day, she gets fed up. And she's like, today I will not be denied. And when no one else is around, she goes and she grabs him by the robe. And she says, come to bed with me. And I mean, he was the slave, right? Like, this is like his boss. Like, he kind of like has to listen, right? He had an excuse. He had an out. She had come after him over and over and over again. But here's what happens. It says that Joseph ran away. Apparently there was some kind of violent struggle because she ends up holding his clothes and he runs out naked. I want you to think about what would happen. I mean, a woman came up to this young man, invited him to have sex with her, demanded it really, grabbed him by the clothes, and he ran so hard that she was left with his robe in her hands and he ran away naked. That was an extreme measure, wasn't it? An extreme measure. Here's our problem. We don't like to take extreme measures. We often act a lot more like the guy in Proverbs 7. We kind of just inch towards it. We inch towards sexual sin instead of taking extreme measures to run. Remember in that Bible verse that we read at the very beginning from the New Testament, Paul says, flee from sexual immorality. He says, here's how you deal with sexual sin. You run. You run the other direction. This is what Joseph did. He ran. And guess what? He didn't have sex with her. He put in extreme boundaries, extreme measures to avoid sexual sin. But the young man in Proverbs 7 doesn't do that. He just keeps inching towards it. And a lot of times, especially with sex, we live on the edge of a cliff. I want to show you a picture. Those are my feet. This is an unwise choice. On my first anniversary with Karen, we went to Zion National Park in Utah. And we were on Angel's Landing, really famous hike. And on the backside of the hike, there is like a chain that you hold on to as you go up to keep you safe, right? But I strayed to the side. And I did it safely. Like, I did it like this. I like was really scared. I didn't just like walk up to it. I kind of like scooted out and then I took the quick picture. I mean, it's all for Instagram, right? I got a lot of likes. And but this is a really unwise choice. But this is how we live when it comes to sex. We'll get as close as we can to the edge of the cliff. In real life, I know I did this, but it was stupid. In real life, we wouldn't do that. We wouldn't just be like, hey, let's just see what happens. Oh, a gust of wind came, I died. Oh, someone pushed me over accidentally. Oh, I tripped on some little chipmunk ran up my leg and I just fell off to my death. No, we would never do that in real life. But this is what we do with sexual sin. We get as close as we can and we're like, I'll just do enough not to get caught. Well, hopefully it won't hurt me. Hopefully nothing bad will happen and we'll just get as close as we can. And we're surprised when, like the man in Proverbs 7, we fall into sexual sin. But because we kept going towards it, we lived life on the edge of a cliff, whereas Joseph ran from the sexual sin. Wisdom tells us to take extreme measures. Just in the past couple weeks, I've seen some extreme measures in the area of sexual sin. I was talking to a friend of mine who's married. He's my age. And he was asking me where I work out. And I was telling him, he's like, oh yeah, I used to go to the gym there. I was like, oh yeah, cool. Why'd you stop going? And let me just tell you something about my gym. There's a lot of people that invest heavily in their bodies and they're very proud of it. I'll just say it that way. And so there's a lot of skin and there's a lot of good looking people and all that kind of stuff. And he said, there was just too much skin. And I just felt like I had to go to a different gym. You know what I thought to myself? I did not think, oh my gosh, what a prude. I didn't think to myself, I can't believe, I mean, that's so overboard. That's so stupid. You know what I thought to myself right away? How wise is he? That even just seeing the people was too much. And he knew, based on his past experiences, his current circumstances, his future hopes and dreams, that he needed to withdraw his membership from a gym. Not because he was having sex with someone there, but just because it was a dangerous situation, and go to another gym. How extreme are you willing to be? I know someone who currently, I have codes to his phone. And if he wants to download a freaking app, he has to come across town. Let me put in the code. He downloads the app and I put the code back in and he drives away. It takes an hour. You know what I don't think to myself? Man, he's so stupid. He's wasting gas money. You know what I think to myself? He's really wise. Because he would rather drive an hour to download an app than to fall into sexual sin, than to be addicted to pornography. And so he will give control of his technological devices to me and make sure that he cannot get to pornography. I know countless people in my life, girls and guys, who have said, I'm going to step away from dating for 6 months, a year, 2 years, whatever it is. Not because dating is bad, not because it's wrong, but because based on their past experiences, their current circumstances, and their future hopes and dreams, they say, I don't need to be in a relationship right now. I don't need the temptation. It's not what I need to focus on myself or my relationship with God. I need to take some space to rest relationally. And you know what I think about those people? Great. Wise. They are taking extreme measures to protect themselves in the area of dating and sexuality. Listen, you're not going to regret that time that you didn't have a phone in your room at night. I promise you. But you will regret a sexual addiction, a pornography addiction. You won't regret not dating for a little while, but you will regret a bunch of broken sexual relationships in your past. You won't regret having too many boundaries growing up, but you will regret having a long sexual past that you wish you could take back. You will regret some of the consequences that come from sexual relationships that will stay with us for much longer than a couple of months. And so you have the choice to make, and it's for you. I'm not going to make you do it. God's not going to make you do it. It's your choice. Are you going to be wise when it comes to the area of sex? What is the extreme step you need to take to protect yourself in the area of sex? What is the extreme step you need to take to protect yourself in the area of sex? And you might be asking, well, Ryan, how extreme do I have to be? I don't know. How safe you want to be? Some people might be like, well, I'll just stay 6 feet from the cliff. Other people might be like, I'm going to stay like off the mountain. I'm not even going to get close. Is either one wrong or right? No. One person says this is going to be wise for me. The other person says this is going to be wise. But here's the thing. The closer you get, the more difficult it might be. The closer you get, the more difficult it might be. How extreme should I be? Well, how extreme do you want your future spouse to be? I don't know. It's your life. How extreme do you want your little brother or little sister to be? How extreme do you want, I know this is a crazy thought, but how extreme do you want your future children to be? I don't know. But if you would want it for someone else, I would hope you'd want it for yourself. I mean, it's your life. It's your relationships. It's your body. And so be wise with the way that you approach your sexual decisions. Wisdom says take extreme measures. What is that extreme step? And I've told young guys before, I don't know that anyone's ever taken me up on it, but I've told young guys, and I'm not saying guys are the only one that struggle with this, but I've told young guys who struggle with pornography to tell their parents and to say, I need you to take my phone every night. I'm going to give it to you at 9 p.m. and you can give it to me in the morning so I don't look at porn. But guess what? I've never had a teenager say, okay, I'm going to do it. But guess what? If that teenager did it, they probably wouldn't look at pornography. How serious are you about fighting the sexual temptation? How serious are you? Again, this is not about right or wrong. It's about wise or unwise. And I want to close with this because I know that we are in a room where people have made sexual mistakes, probably all of us or most of us. And if you haven't, that's amazing. And hopefully this will be wisdom for you moving forward. But if you have, I want to just share something with you that's really important. Jesus was maybe the most kind, protective, and loving towards people who sinned sexually. One time a woman caught in adultery is thrown in front of him and he protects her. He speaks up for her. He forgives her. He gives her grace. He does not remind her of her past, and he encourages her towards the future. There's a verse in the end of the Bible, towards the end of the New Testament, in 1 John chapter 1, verse 9, and it says this: if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. So I want to just give you all the opportunity right now. You bow your heads, close your eyes, and I just want to give you this opportunity. If you know that there's an area of your life where you've messed up sexually, I want to invite you to just ask for forgiveness. We can't change the past, but we can get forgiveness for the past. We can be redeemed for the past. And then moving forward, we can live a life with fewer regrets. So if that's you, with your heads bowed and eyes closed, I just want to invite you, if you want prayer over that area of your life, over a sexual sin, just to raise your hand. If you're brave enough to do that, just raise your hand. And let me pray over you. You could pray this prayer with me. Heavenly Father, forgive me. Forgive me for whatever area of my life I've messed up sexually. Give me your grace, your forgiveness, your love. And even if I feel guilty and shameful, Lord, you have redeemed me. Lord, I pray forgiveness over each person in this room that's struggling with sexual sin. I pray strength. I pray that they would live a life that is wise, not unwise. That they would pursue wisdom in the area of sexual sin. That they would take whatever that difficult, extreme step is tonight to change their future. Because ultimately, you want what's best for us. You want freedom for us. And maybe nothing is more trapping sexual sin. So Lord, help us make decisions that remove us from those areas. In your name we pray. Amen. Amen. We're going to close in worship as always. If you want to stand, stand. If you want to sit, sit. If you want to come down to the prayer rails and pray, pray. If you want to fill out a prayer card and you want our team to pray over you during the week, do that. And let's respond to God as we feel led.
Before I even knew.
just hear the Father saying that He loves you. That His arms are wide open. That His presence is a safe place to bring your burdens, to bring your struggles, to bring your shame. And if you're ready, He's wanting you to experience His love. His love that is greater than anything. It's greater than pleasure. It's greater than a temporary feeling. It is sustaining and it is fulfilling. And it's available to you.
Kindness to me. And For me, he loves like a is our prize. Drawn to redemption by the grace in his eyes. If grace is an ocean, we're all sinking. We are his portion, and she is our prize. Drawn to redemption by the grace in his eyes. If grace is an ocean, we're all sinking. Sing that one more time. We are his portion, he is our prize. Drawn to redemption by the grace in his eyes. If grace is an ocean, we're all sinking. So
sing it one more time, but let's say you, how you love me. Make it personal for yourself. I know we always sing it that way, but let's just do that for a second. So just keep singing it together, how you love me.
You love me, oh, how you love me. We're all sinking.
guys can all have a seat. Something that really resonated with me during the sermon tonight was just understanding how important it really is to have those extreme boundaries set in your life, not just in a sexual aspect as we talked about tonight, but in all facets of your life. Just having those boundaries set up for yourself is really important. And also, if you're new and you filled out that Connect card, remember to take it to the back. Tyler's got his hand up right now, and he will give you a free t-shirt just for being here.
We also have the books going on sale for $10 in the back.
We do.
And then we have Rising Tide coming up next Saturday. It's from 10 to 12. It's really awesome. It's at Portside. Or not next Saturday. Saturday after that? I don't know. Next Saturday, yeah. From 10 to 12, it's at Portside. It's really fun. You just kind of play games, do crafts with all the kids there. It's a really rewarding experience. It's awesome. You should go. And then lastly,
after the service, upstairs, I'm pretty sure Jacob's going to be there hosting the meeting. There's a small, about 10-minute serve meeting. Just go there after the service. There's no commitments or anything to sign up for. And just go there and hear about how you can serve more here at Beach Church.
We'll see you next week.